Our next talk is by Supervisory Special Agent Joel, is it DeCapua? Close enough, that's what I like to hear. On feds fighting ransomware, how the FBI investigates and how you can help. Please welcome Joel.
Hi, everybody. So my name is Joel DeCapua. I work for the FBI. I'm a special agent, and I'm in a unit called the Global Operations and Targeting Unit. Our acronym is GOTO. We like to think of ourselves as kind of like some mad scientists within the cyber division. We work on a lot of cybercrime cases. We're known as the Dolphin Group. Highly intelligent, yet incapable of communicating with humans. We take a lot of pride in that. So today I want to talk about something completely unique, which is ransomware. I thought I'd give everyone a nice little change. And in particular, I have 30 minutes to teach you guys what a win looks like for the FBI in terms of ransomware, what type of tools we use in order to investigate ransomware, and also ways that you can help us join the fight. Also, I have a very cartoonishly ridiculous amount of slides that I have to fit in 30 minutes, so excuse me for blasting through this at the speed of light. So, first off, what's an FBI win look like? Well, lock them up. Here's an example of Cerber ransomware and CTB Locker. We were able to get the Romanians to arrest some of the affiliates. Here's an example of a ransomware called Reviton, which actually was a pre-cryptocurrency ransomware that we successfully identified the perpetrator and then had the NCA arrest him. And here's an example of the money launderers behind Reviton also being held accountable. Also, take their stuff. This is important. We use seizure in order to take the ill-gotten gains of ransomware. And also, we're using treasury sanctions now in order to impose an additional cost, which I think in the future, this is going to be something that grows more as time goes on. Next, we break their things. So the FBI actually, sometimes if ransomware has really bad encryption routines, we have smart people that figure out ways to beat it. It's rare, but sometimes if a victim comes to us and says, hey, we've been infected with this ransomware, we can say, hey, here's the master decryption key that we figured out, or here's a flaw in the encryption routines where you guys can break it. Also, a lot of people in the private sector come to us and say, hey, we have the master decryption keys for this specific variant, or we know a secret within the malware that might be able to get victims' data recovered. Unfortunately, we can't tell you which variants they are, because if we told you, the bad guys will fix them. But if you are infected or one of your clients are infected, come to us and we'll let you know if we have a back door. Or I shouldn't say a back door, if we have a way to decrypt the ransomware. And here's an example, GanCrab. For the longest time, we had the ability to decrypt GanCrab. And eventually we went public and released it so everyone could also decrypt it. And of course the bad guys just changed their malware immediately. Next, call them out. You heard Bill Hall of the Department of Justice talk about the SAMSAM investigation. That's an example of where we publicly indict and call out individuals who deployed ransomware. This was the SAMSAM subjects. Also, the Crypto Locker, which was kind of like one of the original ransomwares. Here's Mr. Bogachev, who is allegedly behind that. And make crime hard. So this is near and dear to my heart. Ransomware would not be successful without the cyber criminal ecosystem that supports it. And what I'm talking about here, I'm talking about rogue virtual currency exchanges. I'm talking about crypting services that people use to pack encrypt malware to make it fully undetectable by AV, FUD. I'm talking about the hacking forums where ransomware authors talk to their affiliates and recruit affiliates. I'm talking about the counter antivirus services where ransomware authors run their malware through to see if it'll be detected by AV. I'm talking about the marketplaces where people are buying and selling RDP access to networks. And we're going to talk a lot more about this. And one of the big focuses from my point of view that the FBI is taking moving forward, one of our big strategies against ransomware, is to hold the people accountable who are big players in this underground cyber criminal ecosystem. Here's some examples. In 2018, there was a study done by Princeton and NYU and a couple private sector entities, and they basically wanted to look at all the ransomware wallets they could find and figure out where the money was going. How are the ransomware actors cashing out their ill-gotten gains? And what they did is they took all the wallets, they were able to calculate there was $16 million of ransoms that were paid. And their study, you guys should take a look at it, it goes into detail about how the bad guys were able to get that money and then incorporate it into the financial, into banks so they can buy stuff with it. Black Hat 2017, an engineer from Google gave a presentation, and the grand conclusion of their study was that 95% of ransomware was cashed out at a virtual currency exchange called BTCE. Now, some of you may remember BTCE. It was the off-the-books virtual currency exchange. They never asked you for any personal information. They had no AML, KYC compliance. No one knew who owned them, but they were one of the most popular virtual currency exchanges for a very, very long time. Well, we took notice. BTCE was taken down by the IRS working in conjunction with the Secret Service, HSI, and the FBI. The person who was allegedly behind it was arrested in Greece, and he was extradited recently to France in order to undergo a trial. Here's another great example. Scan4U is a counter antivirus service. These things are so important in the cyber criminal underground ecosystem. This is, like I mentioned before, where malware authors test their malware to make sure it's not going to be picked up by AV. It's virus total for crooks. We were able to take down the biggest one, and the creator went to prison for 14 years. He went to trial, was found guilty, and he's serving a 14-year prison sentence. Also, Xdetic. Xdetic was the biggest RDP marketplace in the world. It's where lots and lots of ransomware actors would go and purchase access to their victim's network. A lot of ransomware actors aren't sophisticated hackers. They're buying network access, and then they're deploying their ransomware. We find this all the time. And when we're able to take down marketplaces like this, it just makes their job a lot harder. So I love data, and I love new stuff. So here's some new data. So what I did is I kind of recreated that study I showed you, where they looked at the ransomware proceeds of all the wallets they could find back in 2018. But I used all the FBI's ransomware wallets that we've collected. We collect wallets from victims who report incidents to us. We work with private sector partners. We also troll virus total and look for, you know, ransom notes. And we put all this stuff together, and then we look at it and analyze it, and we try to figure out, you know, where's the money going and what's the scope of the ransomware threat? So question one, how much ransomware proceeds have been paid? $144 million is how much we could track. Here are the disclaimers. There's a defined date range on this. This is Bitcoin only, but it's the vast majority of ransomware proceeds are paid in Bitcoin. And it does not quantify any type of losses. Like, this is just the amount of ransom paid. Question two, which variants raise the most money? I think some people will be surprised to see Ryuk as such a significant ransomware variant. Number two is Crisis Dharma. One thing that surprised me was all the off-brand ransomware, the blue. I didn't expect that. But if you wanted to create your own ransomware, you just have to go on GitHub. The code is there. Very advanced versions of ransomware is available on GitHub. You just take it. The disclaimers are it's for educational purposes only, but you change the virtual currency wallet to your wallet, you write any note that you want, and you can deploy it on the victim system. So the next question I wanted to answer is, where did the proceeds go? So we found the majority of it went to, or almost the majority, went to virtual currency exchanges. Now, this is not directly transferred. I'm not talking about direct transfers to virtual currency exchanges. I'm talking about maybe there's one or two or three intermediary hops, but indirectly, the first wallet that we recognize that ransomware proceeds went to is a virtual currency exchange. Also, something surprising for me here was mixers. mixers were not as predominant as I thought they would be. And I think the reason is there's no recourse when a mixing service rips you off. So if you want to launder $500,000 in Bitcoin through a Bitcoin mixer, what's stopping the Bitcoin mixer from just stealing your money? It happens all the time. So the next question is, okay, what exchanges? What exchanges are the ones that ransomware actors are cashing their money out? I really wanted to tell you guys, but I decided to redact the actual names of the exchanges, except for BTCE, because it no longer exists. Now, these numbers are direct exchanges. So that means that from the actual wallets that the victim paid, the money went directly to an exchange. And so we have them right here. This is a real problem. So very quickly, I just want to go over some of the things that you can do to protect yourself. RDP is still 70 to 80% of the initial foothold that ransomware actors use. That's not very surprising for me. It may be surprising for you. There's ways to secure this, network level authentication, also using complex passwords. Most of the RDP is brute forced, and it's brute forced because there's really, really bad passwords, or there's really complex passwords that are just reused all over the place, and then they end up on some password cracking list. Number two, patch all the things. If the initial foothold isn't by RDP, then it's probably by phishing. If it's not phishing, then it's probably some RCE that's out in the wild. And it's almost always an operating system exploit that needs to be patched. If you patch your operating systems quickly and all the applications you have running on your computers, you're gonna be in a lot better position to protect yourself from ransomware. Passwords, I'm not gonna lecture you about passwords, but I tell people don't use human readable passwords. It's too easy to crack a hash. It's way too easy. If you use software Hashcat, it's open source. It has gotten so advanced and so good at predicting how humans make passwords. There's all these rules that you can apply that basically just run through all the different ways that us, when we think we're creating a complex password to a computer, it's not actually complex. So I tell people, if you can tell your password to someone else in under 30 seconds, it's probably not a secure password. Use a password manager, but you guys are security people, you guys know this. So even if you do all these things, you're still gonna get hacked. Someone's gonna click something. And so we tell people, monitor your network. You're not gonna prevent an intrusion, but actors get really, really noisy when they're moving laterally and trying to escalate their privileges. And this is where you catch them. It's not a big deal if one endpoint is ransomware, right? But what the ransomware actors want is they wanna be able to move up your domain controller. They want root on your domain controller. And if you have a well-monitored network, you can catch that and you can stop it before it happens. Also have a plan and a backup, preferably an offline backup. All right, so how does the FBI investigate? The FBI is very, very decentralized. This surprises people. They think we're some gigantic, you know, organization based in Washington, D.C. We're actually field-based. There's 56 field offices. All of our cyber resources are out in the field. In terms of ransomware investigations, we have 49 open investigations on ransomware. Each investigation is focused on a different brand. It's not victim-based. You're not gonna have a RIAC victim in one field office and a RIAC victim in another field office. Each brand of ransomware has its own investigation. And those are in 49 different cases, 26 different field offices, and there's one case agent per case. So a case agent is a really important concept that I want to tell you guys about. So the person that leads an investigation within the FBI is called a case agent. Sometimes they're right out of Quantico, sometimes they're a vet with 20 years of experience. They're the ones that call all the shots with an investigation. They're the ones that are the subject matter experts. They're the ones cutting subpoenas and executing search warrants and putting the case together. They're the ones that testify if it goes to trial. They sit right next to the prosecutor during court. They're the ones in charge. So you have a case agent on each ransomware investigation, and then they're matched up with a prosecutor. Prosecutor is, like Bill Hall, who was up here on the stage a couple talks back. He's the guy who's the actual attorney, who's doing all the legal process, and he's the one that goes up and argues in front of a judge and you know, takes the ransomware actor to court if necessary. And then you have all the support personnel. These are the computer scientists and the analysts and the headquarters guys like me that try to enable the case agents so they can effectively do their job. Every time you hear about a big ransomware win, it's because a case agent out in the field had the dedication and the know-how and the smarts to build a team and to take in an investigation and get a success story. And so that's what a case team is made up of. The field model of our investigations. So here's an example of some of the brands of ransomware, and here's the field office that is responsible for those investigations. This may surprise some people, but the SAM investigation was prosecuted out of the district in New Jersey. It was because it was run by the Newark field office of the FBI. Also, each of our 56 field offices have at least like 4 or 5 agents who just work cyber exclusively. Some of our larger field offices, like San Francisco, are gonna have 40 to 50 agents working cyber. So what are our challenges when we work this stuff? Well, number one, turnkey ransomware. What am I talking about here? So here's an example from exploit.in. This is an actual ransomware actor. And the thing I want to draw your attention to is under the, where it says, excerpt from the rules, it is forbidden to work in the CIS. And starting rate from 60% in your direction after the first 3 payments, 70%. So basically, this is someone who's built ransomware and he's looking for affiliates to install it. So the guy that built the ransomware doesn't have any networks to install it on, so he's looking for subcontractors. And he's willing to pay them a cut, an increasing cut, of any type of proceeds they get. This is ransomware as a service. This guy actually uses ransomware as a service in his actual post. So this is actually the Soda Nakibi actor advertising. And most ransomwares are the affiliate model. Here's another one. This guy's name is Ghost in Web. Here's the Russian, here's the translated version. And again, it's recruiting people who are willing to deploy this stuff, recruiting affiliates. It's easy to buy access to victims. So what am I talking about here? I'm talking about these marketplaces that exist that sell hacked computers. They call them RDPs or shells. The Russian term for it is dedict. It stands for dedicated server, but really just means someone else's computer that you've hacked and now you're willing to sell. And if you look here, it has the prices of RDPs. So you see $3.50, $1, $10, $13, then it gives the location. It doesn't give the IP address because then people will pick and choose, they can do research on what the company is before they buy it. So you just kind of have to, you're gambling, you're guessing, you're hoping you get a big enterprise. You hope it's something where it's a foothold on some network of 5,000 endpoints. So there's a little bit of gambling here. When these ransomware affiliates are spreading ransomware, they're buying up 100 of these, spending some money, and then they log into each of them. Maybe some of them are already burned, the password credentials don't work anymore. But then they look around the network, they say, what is this? Is there any way that I can escalate my privileges? Can I move to domain controller? And then they spend a couple $1,000 to buy these up. They spend some time poking around in the networks, and maybe they find that one hospital or they find that one enterprise that then they can get the domain controller and deploy a ransomware. Then here's just another example. This is a Black Batman, and he's saying, we buy up dedics for crypto. And again, he wants admin rights, no Amazon, payment upon execution. And you can find this stuff on the internet. This isn't on Tor. This is just hacking forums that are pretty prevalent, mostly Russian language. It's easy to launder money. So like I said, a lot of these virtual currency exchanges, they do no anti-money laundering. And so it's easy to launder money. It's easy to stay anonymous. Here's a hacking forum where it's a post about bulletproof hosting services and anonymous VPSs. And people are talking about selling VPSs where they don't even take the client's name. You pay them in Monero, and they don't respond to law enforcement. And they gladly say they don't keep any type of logs of user activities. These are the types of VPSs that ransomware authors are going to want to use. And then here's just a Google search I did of anonymous VPS. And it's amazing this type of stuff that comes up. Uncensored bulletproof hosting there at the bottom, nicevps.net. And then the SCID training wheels. So this is a controversial topic in cybersecurity. I'm talking about the Metasploits and the Autosploits and the PowerShell Empires and the Cobalt Strikes. All the ransomware actors are using these nowadays. They're too easy. They're intended to be pen testing tools, but they have been fully adopted by criminals. And then also the exploits. So whenever Microsoft patches something on their operating system, Patch Tuesday, a lot of really smart security researchers will start tearing apart the patch to figure out what exactly Microsoft patched. And if there's any RCEs in there, it's only a matter of time before proofs of concept start showing up on GitHub and people start tweeting, bragging, like, hey, I have a proof of concept of this RCE that Microsoft patched. And then it's just a matter of time before it gets ported into Metasploit. So BlueKey, Eternal Blue, all of them got ported into Metasploit. Eternal Blue was ported into Metasploit within like 1 month of it being patched or something like that, which is ridiculous because you have this extraordinarily complex RCE that suddenly anyone can deploy using Metasploit. It's super easy. BlueKeep, there was a little bit more of a delay, and I think it was because the security community, they saw what happened with Eternal Blue, and they were like, hey, let's not put this thing out into the wild yet until we know that for certain bad guys are using it and pen testers actually need to test their systems against it. Then you have jurisdictional issues. So again, we saw this post where it says you can only deploy it in the CIS, or you can't deploy it in the CIS. So this is the CIS. It's basically the former USSR. And the reason that a lot of these ransomware actors tell their affiliates they can't deploy it in the CIS is because that's where they live. And they think if we live here and we're not committing any crimes against people in this territory, then our home government won't take any action against us. So, how does the FBI respond to all this? The US legislature has given us some tools, some very powerful tools that allow us to actually make a dent in some of this activity. And what I'm talking about are grand jury subpoenas, search warrants, remote searches, and utilizing the MLAT treaties. And basically, we're just able to go to providers and get additional information from them. Data, evidence, those sorts of things. So what are our outcomes? We already talked about this a little bit. Arrests, releasing decryption keys, sanctions, and public indictments. So what's the security community's role? Every single ransomware success story that the FBI has, there is almost always someone from the security community standing behind us who assisted profoundly in our investigation. So our secret weapon is the community. And what do I mean by this? Well, your dead end is our opportunity. So say you're able to trace a ransomware actor and you're able to find some of their infrastructure overseas and you want to write a blog post about it because you're basically at an impasse. There's nothing else that you can do. Well, if you bring that IP address to us, we can write a mutual legal assistance treaty. We can go overseas and try to get the data on that server, and that can begin our investigation. We can start to attribute these guys. Also, virtual currency wallets. We're really interested in the ransom wallets that folks have. So if you're an incident response company or you're a victim of ransomware, we really want to know about your wallets because we can track some of this money, and our goal is to seize it. And if we're able to seize it, then we're able to refund it to the victims. We're not interested in who your clients are. I know people are very embarrassed when they get hit by ransomware. They're embarrassed that they pay. We don't care about who the clients are. We just care about what the wallets are and where the money went. Same thing with suspicious domain names. There's stuff that we can do with suspicious domain names that the security industry can't. You guys want to out them. We can take the domain names down. We can sinkhole them, those types of things. And also prioritization. It's important. We're very victim-based. We don't open an investigation until someone usually comes to us and says, hey, we've suffered some type of loss. That's why it's important for us to get information from the security community so we can better prioritize how we spend our resources in order to deal with the biggest threats. But what's in it for you? So you're going to work with the FBI. What's going to be in it for you? Well, we can make you a famous internet vigilante. So I don't know if you guys heard about this. this guy is awesome. His moniker is Demon Slay. He runs the website ID Ransomware, which is an incredible tool. He has decrypted so many different variants of ransomware that we couldn't really stand by. We had to make sure this guy was recognized for all his assistance. And then there's an awesome ProPublica article. I recommend you guys check it out. You can protect your partners and clients. So what do I mean by this? So one thing that we use is whenever there's a major ransomware takedown or really any other type of investigation, we like to mention all the private sector companies that assisted us in the investigation. So here's an example. So this is an investigation where a bunch of banks in New York were hacked. This is where the main hacker is pleading guilty. And if you look, we call out the FSISAC, which was, you know, the information they provided us cracked the case. We couldn't have done it without them, and we thought it was important to acknowledge them. Also, how do you differentiate yourself when there's lots of people who are, you know, offering the same products and services? So for instance, you go to the expo hall, some people differentiate themselves by giving out the best swag, some people hired like dancers, but what really impresses me is when you're able to actually take down some botnets. So here's an example. It was a botnet that was taken down by our New York office. It was a digital advertising fraud botnet, and we received tons and tons of support from a company called White Ops, and Google, and a bunch of other companies. White Ops made it a major marketing point. They talk about, you know, how the information that they provided resulted in this great outcome for us. And then they did more press and more press. And they did a talk with the FBI agent who was the case agent. So it was a really great win for everyone. And then just generally cleaning up your industry. AV companies have been really good with this. So for instance, Scan4U, which was a counter antivirus service that was just prolific. Nation state actors were using it. Cyber criminals were using it. The FBI wouldn't have been able to do it without Trend Micro's assistance and other folks working in the AV space. And there's a Wired article where how security researchers caught the creators of counter antivirus service Scan4U. Good stuff. And then finally, it's the right thing to do. You're cleaning up the internet. Here's another example. This is the Mirai botnet. Again, our press release talks about all the different companies that provided tons of assistance. And we think that it's valuable for us to call out these companies and say, hey, like, this is the great stuff that you folks have done. So how can you help? How do you get started? Well, hopefully you guys have relationships with the people who sit in all the field offices. One of the things that we're charged with is we're supposed to go out and make relationships with security researchers and companies. And you can join your local InfraGuard. You can go to different talks and stuff that's put on by the FBI. Get a contact in your local office. So if you think that you can maybe provide some information, or if you say a client of yours is hit by ransomware and you want to see if we have a decryption tool, you know, have someone that you can actually call up. Suppose you're interested in some major botnet. Suppose you're interested in Emotet. You have some insight that you don't think anyone else knows about Emotet. I can put you in touch with the Emotet case team. We have a dedicated case team working Emotet, and they would love to hear from you. And this goes for pretty much everything else that is under the FBI's purview. So maybe you don't know anyone at the FBI, and you're looking for someone, you know, to reach out to. Everyone told me this is a mistake. When they said it was a seminar, I didn't expect this many people. But here is my email address. So rip my inbox. Just disclaimer, I have no spending authority whatsoever, so I don't want any pitches or but if you want to be connected with someone, reach out to me. Part of my job is I'm kind of like an air traffic controller. So if you have some insight on a piece of ransomware that you think no one else has and is not already out there, let me know. Or if you guys are going to go live with an article or a blog post on your website or something where you're going to out a bunch of infrastructure, let me know like the day before. Because the minute that you release that, it's all going to get burned down by the actor. But if you let me know before, I can preserve all that stuff. So maybe that evidence can live on and we can get some real attribution. So that's all I got. That was a lot of stuff I just plowed through, so thank you for your patience. With that, we have a little bit of time for questions, don't we? About 5 minutes. So if anyone has any questions, please go up to the podium. Can you go up to the microphone? Sorry.
I just have a really quick question. In terms of the prosecution of these actors, I know that the legal structures around it have really kind of taken a while in catching up with all the new stuff that's happening and how it's being done. So how big is that gap now from your perspective? Is there still things in your investigations and approach that are limited by the legal structures that are in place?
Yeah. So most of the laws that we use to investigate cybercrime are 20, 30 years old. And we try to educate Congress. We try to, you know, send people to the Hill. I mean, it's time to start refreshing things and rethinking it. It is a major encumbrance on us, for sure. Hopefully, you know, that answers your question. Go ahead.
Why didn't you mention InfraGuard, your local chapters?
I did mention InfraGuard. I did. InfraGuard is important. Some chapters are better than others. They advertise. It's basically where people just get together with the FBI. It's infrastructure guardians. So they're just kind of protecting critical infrastructure, and they have meetings and they do activities. They'll take you to like the shooting range and you can shoot Tommy guns and stuff. But then also they sit with you and say, hey, help us prioritize what we should be looking at and, you know, help us with our investigations and those types of things. Go ahead.
Do you think that ransomware payments should be insurable?
So that's a great question, and that is way above my pay grade. I will say this. No one wants to pay the ransom actors. And I think a lot of companies, they get insurance now, and they say, well, if we are hit by ransomware, we're just going to defer to what our insurance company wants to do. And that alleviates any type of moral, you know, I don't know what you would call it, that goes into, they can say it wasn't their choice to pay the ransom. Because like I said, nobody wants to pay the ransom. So I think that because ransom payments are insurable, I think that it has caused more ransom payments to be paid. Just to be sure, we do not advocate the paying of ransoms. Don't pay ransoms. We've had people pay ransoms and not get their data back. A lot of times when you pay the ransom, the actor actually has a bunch of other backdoors on their system. You're not going to get what you want. It's not going to turn out good. We encourage people don't pay ransoms, but we do understand when people are in those terrible situations that they have to make difficult choices. But come to us. Maybe we can decrypt the ransomware for you. Any other questions? All right, well, thank you. I will be around. Don't be shy to come up and ask questions of me. I have business cards. I'll be in the back. You'll see me all throughout the week. I like to talk to people, so come say hello.